Welcome to The Spoonie Struggle. This is your host, Jessica. I'm a neuropsychologist and longtime spoonie with Ehlers-Danlos, POTS, and a whole host of other syndromes. This show is about the raw, honest look at living life with chronic illness and pain, especially those that are difficult to diagnose and less well-known and understood. Full disclosure, any information discussed in this podcast is strictly the opinion of the host and of the guests and is for informational purposes only. Is not meant as medical advice and should not be taken as such. Always consult with your doctor and medical team. Living with chronic illness can be hard. If you ever find yourselves or someone you love in crisis and need someone to talk to, you can always call the National Suicide Hotline Support Lifeline at 1-800-273-TALK. They offer free and confidential support in the USA 24/7. And now, the Spoonie Struggle. The Spoonie Struggle. This is your host, Jessica. Today we're doing a mini episode on the ins and outs of lupus. And as I mentioned last time, lupus is an autoimmune disease much like Sjogren's syndrome, and it tends to be comorbid with other things like Sjogren's syndrome, rheumatoid arthritis, Raynaud's, and sometimes antiphospholipid syndrome. So lupus is a chronic or long-term disease that can cause inflammation and pain in really any part of your body. It more commonly affects things like the skin, the joints, and the internal organs like the kidneys and hearts. But because it can affect different parts of the body, it can cause lots of different symptoms. So you're probably seeing a theme here in that a lot of these disorders can cause problems in a lot of different areas of the body. So everyone can look a little bit different. Other thing about lupus is that there are different types of lupus, but I'm going to focus mainly on SLE. So that's the more common type of lupus. There are actually a lot of different famous people with lupus, including Selena Gomez, Toni Braxton, Nick Cannon, Seal, and Kristen Johnston. So what are the symptoms? So extreme fatigue is huge. Pain or swelling in the joints, especially swelling in the hands and feet or sometimes around the eyes, headaches, low fevers, sensitivity to sunlight or even to the inside fluorescent light, and chest pain when breathing deeply. There's one thing that people have probably heard about related to lupus, and that's the butterfly-shaped rash on the cheeks and the nose. That's one of the more common symptoms. Other types of symptoms include hair loss, sores in the nose or mouth, and Raynaud's, which I mentioned last time, was the fingers and toes turning white or blue and feeling numb when the person's cold or stressed. So who's at risk for developing lupus? Well, anyone can develop lupus, but the people who are more at high risk are people who have a family member with lupus or even another autoimmune disease, more commonly affecting women ages 15 to 44, and certain racial or ethnic groups. So the ones who are more susceptible include African Americans, Asian Americans, individuals who are Hispanic or Latino, Native Americans, or Pacific Islanders. So SLE, or systematic lupus erythematosus, has a prevalence of about 20 to 150 individuals per 100,000. But if you're looking at women specifically, it is about 164 Caucasian women per 100,000 or 406 African American women per 100,000. So as I briefly alluded to before, lupus, much like other autoimmune diseases, does tend to run in families, but some of the experts are thinking that it might be developed in response to certain other hormones, possibly estrogen or environmental triggers. So estrogen, if that's a link, may be one of the reasons that it's more common in women. So how does one get diagnosed? So I mentioned last time about things like an ANA or a SED rate. They also look at a CBC or a complete blood count to look at the number of red blood cells, white blood cells, and platelets in your blood. They'll look at blood clotting time to see if you have problems clotting, and they'll look at other tests to check for signs of inflammation. They may also do some sort of a skin biopsy from different parts of your body, including the skin, to see if there's any damage or inflammation. And they may do a urine test to see if there are any problems with the kidneys. And sometimes they actually may check it over time to see if a problem develops, if there isn't one to begin with. As far as treatment, as you've probably heard, and you'll probably get sick of hearing, treatment is dependent on a lot of the symptoms and the type of lupus, because there are several types. So some of the more common medications include anticoagulants to help prevent blood clots, especially since folks with lupus tend to have trouble with clotting. There might be anti-inflammatories to help with that inflammation and pain, the anti-malarials, as we mentioned last time, in Sjogren's syndrome, which can protect the skin from rashes and from the bright UV light, some of the biologics, which can help with the immune system in general. There can be immunosuppressives, much like in Sjogren's syndrome, like hydroxychloroquine to help your immune system to keep it from attacking your body, and steroids. That's just a very brief overview of lupus, and I will link people up in the show notes with additional symptoms of lupus, its impact on daily life, and tips and tricks for living with lupus. Well, that's it for our show. Join us next time on The Spoonie Struggle. That's it for our show. To find out more, join us at www.thespooniestruggle.com. That's Spoonie, S-P-O-O-N-I-E. Check us out on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Spoonie Struggle. Please help us out by giving us 5 stars on iTunes and leave us a review so fellow Spoonies can find out what you like about us and discover their community in which to thrive. See you next time on The Spoonie Struggle.